This Week at the Movies, from Nicholas Sparks, the author of The Notebook, Amanda Seyfried and Channing Tatum, star in Dear John.
Will it be the big weepy of 2010?
Letter number 33.
Dear John.
I miss you so much it hurts.
Also coming up this week.
That's how I do things.
John Travolta loves Paris in the springtime, although he destroys about half of it. In the new thriller from the director of Taken, we review From Paris with Love.
People. I don't understand people.
Claire Danes ventures into biopic territory and comes back with a winner in Temple Grandin.
You threaten my son. You threaten me.
Plus, Sandra Bullock is the front runner, but Meryl Streep hasn't won an Oscar since 1983. Who's going to take home the trophy? We'll give you our picks and tell you how to win some prizes of your own in our Outpick the Critics contest.
2 weeks together. That's all it took. 2 weeks for me to fall in love with you. Now we have 1 year apart. But what's 1 year apart after 2 weeks like that together?
We've been complaining for months about how hard it is to get a good laugh from a romantic comedy these days. But what if you want a good cry? I'm A.O. Scott of the New York Times.
And I'm Michael Phillips of the Chicago Tribune.
Our first movie, Dear John, is a five-hanky love story based on a book by Nicholas Sparks, one of whose earlier novels was adapted into the blockbuster weepy The Notebook. Dear John doesn't have the same epic sweep, but it does have a pair of good-looking leads in Amanda Seyfried and Channing Tatum, two nice kids named John and Savannah who fall hard for each other one South Carolina summer. They get caught in one of those sudden downpours that only happen in the movies.
So you used to be tough. Maybe still are a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You don't scare me, John.
No?
Mm-mm.
Well, you scare me.
That's a pretty nice screen kiss. After only 2 weeks together, John and Savannah must part. He's a soldier and duty calls, so they communicate through letters and long for the day they'll be reunited.
Dear John, tell me everything. Write it all down. That way, we'll be with each other all the time, even if we're not with each other at all.
It's a full moon here tonight, which makes me think of you. Half a world away.
Now, the jury is still out on Channing Tatum's acting chops, but his charisma is undeniable. The emotional tone of this movie, directed by Lasse Hallström, is a quiet ache rather than raging angst. A lot happens in Dear John, some of it implausible, much of it shamelessly manipulative. I found myself pushed out of the story sometimes, but almost always drawn into the movie's sweet, sad mood. And if you're in the mood for a good, clean cry, well then, you should see it.
Tony, I'm always in the mood for a good, clean cry.
Well,
I
try to make you cry every week.
Every week. But I say skip it. I think this, all your talk of quiet ache and sensitivity, this is the most baldly engineered and kind of heavily manipulative things. It doesn't have any of the appeal I got from The Notebook. And this film is trying desperately to be The Notebook, as you can tell from the images it's being used to sell.
Well, I think it
doesn't have the acting.
Well, no, I don't agree, actually. I think that Amanda Seyfried is a really good actress. You know, we're going to be seeing a lot of her this year. She's in a movie called Letters to Juliet.
No, she is good. She is
Chloe.
Good, yes.
She's great on Big Love, and I think she really brings a lot of life to a character that is very sketchily written.
Very.
And I think that Channing Tatum, I mean, he's just a sort of a magnetic physical presence. I don't think he's a great actor yet, but I think he's really got something. And I think when the two of them are together, you really feel something.
Here's what, look, with romance novels, and this is basically a screen romance novel, I just think if you're really dealing with two very saintly characters, right? You need some sense of grit or tension within them, and this is the most preordained, predestined thing. I just did not get pulled into it.
No, but this is not a gritty, emotionally intense movie. This is a soft, soothing, lovely,
gauzy,
bubble bath.
Soppy, soupy.
I'm all for it.
Next movie. You might know Claire Danes from the TV series My So-Called Life or film roles like Romeo and Juliet and Shop Girl, but the actress has never played anyone like Temple Grandin, which is also the title of a fascinating and wonderfully acted biopic premiering this weekend on HBO. Now, who's Temple Grandin? Among other things, she's the most famous autistic woman alive today, whose books have helped millions understand her condition. She's also a pioneer in the study of animal behavior.
Danny's looking at you. So you can see all around without moving his head.
So how do you know where he's looking?
His ears. He points his ears where he's looking. See? He's looking at you, and he's looking at those cowboys.
Temple's life as a teenager opens up when she spends a summer in the mid-1960s with her aunt, played by Catherine O'Hara. Julia Ormond plays her mother, who's been told by doctors that Temple's condition is the result of the way she's been brought up. At the time, autism was largely blamed on parenting. Temple's mother knows there's more to it than that, and so does the high school science teacher, played by David Strathairn.
And I know you saw the children making fun of her, and you want to protect her.
Yeah, of course I do.
Yeah, what parent doesn't want to? But at some point, she's going to hit life head on. And trust me, we know how different she is.
Temple's autism and her profound empathy with the animal world leads her to reform the billion-dollar meat industry. How? By designing a way to keep cows calmer and happier on the way to the slaughterhouse. Now, let's be honest, you put together the words autism and slaughterhouse, and film executives tend not to use the words, sure, go ahead, film that, in response. But I'm certainly glad HBO did. Danes is extraordinary here, and Temple Grandin is exactly the kind of idiosyncratic project that gave HBO its reputation in the first place. I say see it. Best film I've seen in a while.
I agree. And, yeah. And certainly the best biopic in a very, very long time. Partly because it doesn't play the usual sort of sentimental narrative. It doesn't follow her from her unhappy childhood to her redemption. It kind of drops you right in the middle of her world and shows you how she sees the world. It captures how her mind works, the experience and perception of an autistic person, really, really, I think, in a brilliant and subtle way.
Subtle, and as we saw in that first clip, where she's explaining why she knows the horse is, you know, aware of them. That kind of technique can really kind of suffocate a movie if you overuse it, if the special effects or the graphics are too flashy. And I like what you say about being dropped into it, because we don't get, you know, we don't really get explanations about Temple's childhood, as you say, until 20, 30 minutes in, after we've really gotten to know her on her own terms. And Danes, you know, besides nailing the real life character's voice, you know, wonderfully in a lot of the mannerisms, it's just, you know, she's really one of the best actresses going right now.
She's becoming, and she's at an interesting phase in her career. You know, she started out young in My So-Called Life and sort of never quite became, you know, the sort of the it girl in her 20s, has done some really interesting dramatic and comic roles. And now in this, she is really exploring a whole other dimension and showing something really amazing.
She will have a good long career.
Yes, absolutely. Coming up next, can John Travolta make up for the flop Old Dogs? We'll review the new action thriller From Paris with Love.
Did I say we were done?
And later, a look at a trilogy that at least one critic has said is better than The Godfather.
Please, tell him about the others. Please.
And you know we can probably get that drink in any supermarket?
Yeah, I know that too.
So what's the big deal over some corn syrup, caffeine, and water?
Well, the big deal is my secret ingredient, which I cannot take the chance that they would find out about.
That was a scene from our next movie, From Paris with Love. John Travolta plays a secret agent dude named Charlie Wax, and given his hyperactive performance in this loud, obnoxious little action thriller, that energy drink is probably the last thing he needs. Travolta partners up with Reese, a diplomatic flunky played by Jonathan Rhys-Meyers, to do a lot of killing, bantering, and blowing stuff up.
Okay, let me get my head around this. You want to stop in the middle of our getaway so you can grab your plates, wipe your prints, and grab some files.
I'll be quick.
All right, quicker than this.
Work for you?
Now, that counts as a quiet moment in this movie, produced by French schlockmeister Luc Besson and directed by Pierre Morel, who did the much better revenge thriller Taken. The harder From Paris with Love strains for wit, the dumber it gets.
I'm actually in the cloak and dagger division of the embassy, like my boy here.
Mostly cloak.
Mostly dagger.
Killed anyone today?
Well, let's see. About, what, one an hour on average, I'd say.
Eventually, they encounter a surprise twist that's as hard to miss as the Eiffel Tower on a sunny day. Rhys-Meyers butchers his Yank accent, while Travolta butchers just about everyone in sight and threatens to chew through every monument in the City of Lights with his manic, profane, over-the-top energy. It's kind of fun to watch him do this for 10 or 12 seconds, but it gets awfully tired after that. So enjoy the trailer. I did. But skip the movie.
Tony, I say see it. And I just think if you actually say Taken, directed by the same director as you say, Pierre Morel, is a better film in any way than this. This is stupid. Yes, it's stupid. Stupid with two O's.
All right. Well,
but I think this guy.
Checkmate.
I think this guy really knows how to film action. It's not like the kind of nonsense you get with a Brett Ratner film, you know, like Rush Hour. It's not that kind of grinding formula.
I don't agree.
It's good.
He knows how to put together third-rate imitations of John Woo
Peter Greengrass.
No, it's a mixture. There's no coherence. There's no consistency. It's like, you know, let's have John Travolta jump in through a window and shoot a bunch of guys. Let's have John Travolta run downstairs and shoot a bunch more guys. Hey, I know. Let's have John Travolta drive down a highway chasing a Volvo and blow
with
it up
the bazooka, with the bazooka at least.
You know, but the bazooka was as subtle and witty as.
Here's the thing. Look, Taken pretended to take place on planet Earth. This does not. This is a comic book at best. But I just think as a kinetic whirligig that actually does the job in 90 minutes and gets you back out on the street, this is one of the better action films I've seen in a few months.
I don't even know what the job that it's doing
okay.
is.
All right.
Coming up next, we're going to tell you who we think will win in the Best Actress and Best Supporting Actress categories at this year's Oscars. It's our Outpick the Critics segment.
And on next week's show, Ashton Kutcher, Jennifer Garner, and almost every other working actor in Hollywood today star in Valentine's Day. And Benicio Del Toro and Anthony Hopkins star in The Wolfman.
I am what they say I am. I'm a monster.
The nominations for the 82nd Annual Academy Awards were announced earlier this week, and we're kicking off our own Oscar competition, Outpick the Critics.
For the next 4 weeks, we'll tell you who we think will win at this year's Academy Awards, and you'll get your chance to challenge us by making your own predictions.
That's right, so let's get started. The nominees for Best Supporting Actress are Penelope Cruz with a surprise nomination as the Maestro's Mistress in the musical Nine.
Guido, everybody knows about me. Why won't you let me near you?
Vera Farmiga is the frequent flyer who catches George Clooney's heart in Up in the Air.
What's your total?
That's a personal question.
Oh, please.
No, we hardly know each other.
Oh, come on. Impress me.
Also from Up in the Air, Anna Kendrick is the hotshot termination expert who's too smart for her own good.
Wow.
And they put your name on the side of a plane.
If you guys don't grow up, it's like you need to pee on everything.
Maggie Gyllenhaal is the journalist who falls for Jeff Bridges' country singer in Crazy Heart.
You're going to be out there. Running around, not even remembering this day.
And Monique as the mother from hell in Precious, based on the novel Push by Sapphire.
You don't know what real women do. Real women sacrifice.
So,
well, I think it's Monique. I think that supporting categories are places where the Academy can acknowledge outsiders. I mean, right. Monique has been a comedian and talk show host, not, you know, an established movie star. She delivers the goods. It's an overpowering performance. It's a performance that's already won and deserved a lot of awards. And I think that the Academy is gonna stay with her.
I suspect the Academy will vote that way because, I mean, I think the reason is they adore villains brought to some sort of dimensional life. I mean, they did it with Javier Bardem in No Country for Old Men. Yep. That's the kind of turn that people respond to within the Academy. So, yes, I think so.
Yes. Monique, we both say. Moving on to Best Actress, the nominees are Sandra Bullock as the real-life Southern firecracker who takes in a homeless high school football player in The Blind Side.
This teen is your family, Michael. When you look at him, you think of me, how you have my back. Are you going to protect the family, Michael?
Yes, ma'am.
Helen Mirren with her fourth nomination as the high-strung wife of Leo Tolstoy in The Last Station.
How dare!
You're all plotting against me in my own house!
Carey Mulligan as a rebellious teenager coming of age in 1960s England in An Education.
So what you're telling me is to be bored and then bored and finally bored again, but this time for the rest of my life.
Gabourey Sidibe as a damaged young woman looking for hope in Precious, based on the novel Push by Sapphire.
Nobody loves me.
People do love you, Precious.
Please don't love me.
And Meryl Streep with her 16th nomination as the world's most famous cookbook author in Julie and Julia.
What is it that you really like to do?
Eat.
And we are so good at it. Look at you. Now,
growing in front of you.
So this has been, you know, this really comes down, I think, to a two-woman race. Sandra Bullock, Meryl Streep. And I think, what do you say?
In the time it took you to read that last sentence, I think Streep actually got a 17th nomination just for reading something out loud. Yeah, I agree. It's going to be tight. I think this feels to me like the Academy is going to pick Bullock this year. Uh-huh. She's won a lot for The Blind Side. You know, last year she had two enormous hits that kind of reaffirmed her status as a top-line movie star.
Yeah.
And, you know, she's in the same point in her career, Tony, I think, that Julia Roberts was when she won for Erin Brockovich. She's somebody who started as kind of a somewhat quirky ingenue and has kind of proven herself, I think, to be a real force at the box office. This is her year.
I think that's quite possible, but I think the edge in the end is going to go to Meryl Streep. Meryl Streep has been around for a very long time. She's been nominated 16 times. She's only won twice. The last time she won was in 1983.
Sophie's Choice.
And recently, she's moved away in a very interesting way from those kind of, you know, intense, fully immersed, dramatic roles that she did in the late 70s and early 80s to these comic impersonations that have made her a box office force for the first time in her career.
She is no less a box office force than Sandra Bullock. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. And so I just think that she carries that film, she lifts it up, and people really like her, and I think that it's going to be, you know, down to the wire. But
all right, you think the Academy's going with Meryl Streep? I say the Academy's going to go with Sandra Bullock.
And we'll see what the Academy does.
And make sure to go to our website to fill out your own ballot. You'll be able to compete against Tony or me, or both of us if you choose, and you could win a 46-inch Sony Bravia HD TV or a Sony Blu-ray player and a 25-pack of Blu-ray movies. You just have to outpick the critics. Go to atthemoviestv.com for a complete list of rules and to see our picks in additional categories.
Next week, we'll predict the winners in the Best Actor and Best Supporting Actor categories.
And coming up next, The Killer on the Loose and a deadly ski lift. A look at movies that might be flying under your radar.
Okay, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to give each one of you a year or two of the investigation and 24 hours to get to grips with the files. I want details of cars sighted, descriptions of all witnesses, suspects, whatever. The Yorkshire Ripper's name's in those files. Trust me, we've had him in and let him go.
We're taking a look at some films out in limited release and on demand. We'll start with the Red Riding Trilogy. Tony?
This is really interesting. There's one British critic, David Thompson, who has laid down a pretty big marker on this and said it's better than The Godfather. I don't think it's quite there, but it's an awfully interesting series of movies. Three different directors telling three different episodes in the investigation around the Yorkshire Ripper serial murder cases in the 70s and 80s in Britain.
Yeah, for me, what it reminded me of the most was James Ellroy's L.A. Confidential, which got turned into a very good film.
A little of Zodiac, too.
Although I'd say it's really more L.A. Confidential in that it is a limitless, bottomless amount of depravity and a
corruption.
very lurid plot line, and in a way I felt a little ground down by some of the narratives in that all three films follow similar arcs, but it's got a great sense of atmosphere up in this really grim northern England country. I would recommend it.
I would too, and terrific acting as well. Another movie out there you may not have heard of is Frozen.
Honestly, by the end of it, I couldn't feel my fingers. I was sitting there.
What? Come on.
Oh, come on now. Man, this is so messed up.
Okay, premise, three people stuck on a chairlift. That's it. That's the whole film.
That's pretty much it.
It's a very confined setting for a thriller.
It's like that movie Open Water with the couple waiting to get eaten by sharks. This is like Open Snow, but with wolves instead of sharks, three people instead of two.
And what'd you think?
I thought if it was 25 minutes long, I would have stayed with it. It's just a little, there's not enough here for 90 minutes. Not enough interesting about the characters, not enough, you know, varied in the story and the suspense.
Yeah, I liked it a little bit on that. I'd say rent it on this one. I think he does have a future, and he's actually a better writer than a director at this point, but, you know, I'd say rent it.
Can't decide what to see in theaters? Stay tuned for my Oscar-centric 3 to see.
Closed captioning for At the Movies is sponsored by Hotel provided by Park Hyatt Chicago. Chicago's award-winning hotel and luxury dining experience, located in the heart of Chicago's Magnificent Mile on Water Tower Square.
As we were discussing earlier, the Oscar nominations have just been announced. And in my three to see this week, I recommend some movies still in theaters that got some attention in the acting categories. Number three is An Education. What stands out in this movie is Carey Mulligan's graceful, intelligent, and surprisingly funny lead performance. Number two is A Single Man, a swirling visual confection directed by former fashion designer Tom Ford. It's given gravity and grace by Colin Firth's flawless performance as a gay English expatriate struggling with grief and alienation in sunny early 1960s Los Angeles. And at number one, I have Precious, with two nominated performances. Newcomer Gaboree Sidibe as an abused Harlem teenager, and Monique as her endlessly cruel, profoundly wounded mother. It's not always an easy film to watch, but it's not one you'll ever forget.
Unusually good picks for you, Tony, this week.
Thank you.
I would say people should also add to their list of really things to see this weekend. Temple Grandin on HBO.
Yes.
It's one of the best biopics I've seen in any medium, and Claire Danes, excellent.
Yes, and it's a fascinating introduction to a really fascinating person.
Yes, you bet it is. That's it for now. We'll leave you with a recap of this week's show. Remember, you can follow us on Twitter and on Facebook. Just go to atthemoviestv.com to find out how.
Join us next week for reviews of The Wolfman with Benicio del Toro and Emily Blunt, and Valentine's Day with an all-star cast including Julia Roberts, Bradley Cooper, and Taylor Swift. Until then, we'll be at the movies.